Milwaukee Bucks taking on the Utah Jazz. That game's going to be on NBA League Pass just minutes from now. Now, the Jazz have won two in a row, both on the road, three of their last four overall. Meanwhile, the Bucks are coming off a loss. They haven't lost consecutive games this season, a perfect 10-0 following a loss. Let's hear Coach Quinn Snyder with Craig Bowlerjack prior to the game.
This is game number 41 tonight. What's your thought?
Well, it's hard to believe. We were walking on just coming to practice and walking on the street today, and you still see some Christmas decorations, and Christmas seems like it was 2 months ago. So it's happened fast, and we're growing. I think we're a better team now than when we started the year, and that's, to me, I know, you know, you'd love for the record to, I think you always want the record to be better. Right. But I think as we continue to play and tonight and the next game and beyond, if we can continue to improve, that'll serve us well.
You know, speaking of getting better, listen, let me take you back to Detroit, because you were down 18, but a dynamic second half offensively and defensively. You guys are very active, and Donovan seemed to be the guy that led the charge.
Yeah, you know, really, and you mentioned Donovan in the second half, and he certainly did. I think in the second quarter, really, when Dante and Tabo were in the game, the way those two guys played, and it was tough to see both of them, you know, take an injury, because those two guys, you could really feel. Tabo played the rest of the second quarter. Dante had like 5 assists in 6 minutes. And hard to lose them in that game, and would have also been really easy with those two guys playing well for the rest of the team to kind of let up, and that didn't happen. And you know, Donovan, as much or more than anyone, really midway through the third quarter, he came back in and he really dug in defensively, and I think the game just started kind of unfolding for him, and he was instinctive, and he was really good.
Yeah, he really was. Coach, finally, we're in Milwaukee, which is the home of Giannis Antetokounmpo. And when you speak of him, I mean, just one word pops up. It's just unique.
Yeah.
Maybe you have more.
Terrific, yeah. There's a lot of superlatives that you can use to describe him. And Bud's done an unbelievable job, you know, helping him bring all those talents out kind of exponentially. But some of the statistics that you see that are unique, nobody scored more in the paint since Shaq. So you look at a guy, and you know, he's basically a modern-day Shaq. He's not doing it with post-ups all the time. He's doing it more off, you know, dribble penetration and transition. But he's a really unique player, and that makes it – it's hard because he's so good, but it's also hard because he's so different.
Coach Snyder also mentioned Dante Exum's ankle injury. He's reportedly going to be out for the next 2 weeks. So before I ask you about their matchup with the Milwaukee Bucks, I want to ask, why the slow start for the Utah Jazz, a young team that we were expecting to see take a big jump at the start of the season?
I think a couple of things that jump out at me. When you look at their record right now, they've played 16 home games. They've played 24 away games, and here they are in Milwaukee again tonight. And the fact that they have a 20-20 record, just a game and a half out of the playoffs in the Western Conference, I think says a whole lot. The same thing is, Donovan Mitchell didn't start out the season the same way that he finished up last season. But so did a couple other guys in the league that we've talked about tonight. Didn't start out great, like James Harden, mm-hmm. but he's on fire right now. So if Donovan Mitchell gets back to the form that we saw last year, where he was just simply sensational, and then a couple of these nagging little injuries where guys miss 3, 4, 5 games, you couple that with the brutal schedule, this team's in a great spot to make a run in the second half of the season.
Let me ask you, Kevin, because you and I talk a lot about these young players who the team tends to, well, the league tends to figure out in their mm-hmm. sophomore season. Do you think that that's the case here with Donovan?
No question. When you take the league by storm like Mitchell did, especially the second half of last year, everybody now, you're the number one guy in the scouting report. So the coach stands in front of the group in the morning before the game and says, this is how we're stopping Donovan Mitchell. I'm putting my best defenders on him. I'm forcing him left. He likes to pull up. Whatever your tendencies are, they say we're taking your favorite tendency away, making you play your weaknesses, not your strength. And I, as a young player in this league, it's like a chess match. You start off with the same opening in your chess match 5, 6 times in a row. Finally, the guy says, you're not doing that. You're not beating me with that. You have to change up. I've told this story before. I remember the first time I played in the playoff series against really talented players that were really smart, were Caldwell Jones and Bobby Jones, and they played for Philadelphia 76ers. So I had the move where I'd fake left, turn around, fade away, jump shot. Hell, Bobby Jones jumped before I did. He blocked it. I mean, I hadn't had anybody block that shot since I don't know when. And I was like, dang, like I got to come up with plan B here. They made you play to plan B. They took away your favorite move, and that made me a better player. And I said that Donovan Mitchell earlier this year was going to look at film. Quinn's a really good coach, Snyder. He's going to figure out what the defenders are doing to him, and he's good enough that he'll go to plan B and C and get counters. So I think it's a tough schedule, like Mike said. And then I think it's just, you know, Donovan, the league caught up to him. Now he's figuring out what they're doing, and he's making the next jump. So it's just, you're always doing this. As a young player and you're trying to get here, you do this. All the way up, and he's just on his, you know, just stages of growing up that ladder.
And they're taking on a Milwaukee Bucks team that's sitting. My mom used to call me Special K.
Ooh,
honey. The Spurs win at 119-107. That's their season high fifth win in a row. But they've also gone 13-3 in their last 16 games. Coach, that win moves them up to fifth place, past the Houston Rockets. What is it that stands out about the way this team is playing right now and hitting their stride halfway through this season?
I like their ball movement on the offensive end, and they've incorporated two ISO players in Aldridge, who plays mostly on the box or the elbows, and DeRozan, who doesn't shoot threes, coming off of actions and then getting into his one-on-one game. But they've incorporated those two guys in how they play, alongside of some good three-point shooters now. And they've changed their lineup a couple times. Pop's twisted some stuff around. Defensively, they seem a little bit more aggressive to me than they have been. You know, I mean, they're getting up a little bit more. They're more confident in their schemes. So they're pushing up. Their help is there. And they play very, very good team defense. So if you beat one guy in the Spurs, the other guy's rotating over. You very seldom beat a guy on the Spurs and have a clean layup. They come over, they rotate, they shift, they scramble very well. But it's their ball movement. I like the fact that we talked about it earlier. They're shooting 5 percentage points higher as a team in this run, 13-3. You know, you're taking about 100 shots a game. You're making 5 more shots a game.
Yeah,
that's huge, exactly. And you're talking about some of those being threes, too, because they stopped having a lot of the poorer shooters shooting a lot of threes. Their top guys are knocking down threes. But I like their body and ball movement and just how they're playing. They're hitting stride. They had a whole new team this year, a whole new look. It took a little while to find it. But, again, I've said this a million different times. It's Pops is the gold standard in this league for coaching, and he'll find a way. You give him enough time and he's around that team enough, he'll figure out.
Well, speaking of the Houston Rockets, which is the team that the Spurs just left over in the Western Conference, and the Denver Nuggets, the team sitting atop the Western Conference, the Rockets hold the 10-point lead at halftime, 70-60. James Harden, unsurprisingly, is leading the way with 18 points. He's got 7 assists as well. Let's bring in, again, the czar of the Telestrator. To break down, though, what Nikola Jokic has done thus far, not just what he's done thus far, because he does have 15 points in this one, he also has 7 turnovers. What, though, stands out about his game and what makes him so effective when he is effective?
Let's take a look at the versatility that this young man has. He's very skilled, and they use him all over the court, not just send him down low because of his height. They take advantage of the things that he can do. First, let's look at him as a passer, as a distributor. They'll start him in the low post area, knowing that he can score down there. But he looks over his shoulder, reads the defense. It's a one-on-one with Capella until Tucker comes. As soon as Tucker comes, he drops it off to Millsap for the little short shot on the inside. Let's take a look at him in that post area, get him the ball, and the aggressiveness that he has. Look everything over, start to make you move. Yeah, it's a miss, but he goes right back after, comes up with the offensive rebound, and then scores. Then, on the outside, dribble handoff. I'm going to go down and post up the smaller Tucker. Tucker beats him up a little bit in that post area, so, okay, I don't want to get in a fight. I'll just step out behind the three-point line and watch this one from well behind the three-point line as he knocks down the three. So a number of different facets to his game, a very skilled, young, big man, a guy who I believe I heard you people say could be in the MVP discussions at the end of the season.
Well, at least in our discussion,
yes,
anyway.
Yeah.
If we're talking about it, then he's in the conversation, right? Yeah.
If they end up with the best record in the West, they'll have to talk about Jokic
right.
as an MVP candidate. Mike, how is he? He has 7 turnovers. What's Houston doing to cause him to turn the ball over? He's usually pretty steady with the ball. He gets a little loose once in a while, but he's usually pretty steady.
What we see them doing is they're waiting, and he puts it on the floor. One dribble, two dribbles, and then they come after him from the blind side, hoping that he'll either spin back into that oncoming defender, or the defender has gotten a hand in there two or three times, which has caused him to fumble it, lose control of the basketball. So they're trying to frustrate him after he puts it on the floor. When he catches and looks around, they stay at home. But once he starts to put it down, he's taking the contact from the body of Capella. And then, as you know, Tucker's very physical. When he comes after him or one of the other Houston defenders, they've caused him a little bit of concern.
Mike, you know, that's one of those guys when you work with the big guys. That's if you inside reverse pivot, the old Jack Sigma move, so you keep your face to the guy and you never get your back to the basket where they can come up from behind you. So as you rip and face up, everything's in front of you, you can see it. You know, he's such a young player. He needs to incorporate that, because that's one of the things. When you start dribbling the ball and they start coming from your blind side and everybody's digging, you get some turnovers. But he'll make an adjustment. He's very smart and he's got great hands. I like that big fella.
It always puts tremendous pressure on the defender when the offensive man turns and faces up, because now he becomes that triple threat.
All right. Thanks, Coach Fratello. We'll check back in with you about the Spurs and what's made them so effective in this stretch as we take a look at their first 25 games as opposed to their last 15.
Well, for me, the biggest thing is the defensive rating is they've played so well. I'm always amazed when Pops can get a bunch of slow guys, Mike, to play deep. When your bigs are slow, it's hard to have really schemes that work, because they're always got to be in sag in positions where they're covering small amounts of the floor. But Pops finds a way to get those guys to play good defense. Every time I watch them play and they play good defense, I'm like, how does he get these guys to do that? But their defense has impressed me. And then, you know, they're shooting 5 percentage points better offensively. And in a game where you shoot 100 shots a game, you're making 5 more. I mean, they are taking better shots and taking and making better shots as a team. And he figured out the defensive blend and the offensive blend. Pop's doing a tremendous job. Give him credit.
It's been a juggling act for him the entire season, because he had to decide, how do we want to play offensively now? We lose Danny Green, you lose Kawhi, you lose Slo-Mo, and you've lost some key pieces, okay, to their offense and to their defense, the experience part. He brings in some new guys. Wait a minute, I've got to figure out, how do I best use DeMar DeRozan? And DeRozan has to figure out what's a San Antonio style of play. Pau Gasol has played 10 games so far this season. Rudy Gay has played 35. He's had some key injuries to guys, so he's been juggling and mixing and matching and trying to find the guy that can be a shot maker on a given night. It used to be Patty Mills that would come off the bench. And well, I'd look at the box score right away. I'd look to see what Patty Mills did. If he played well, they would win the game usually. Mm-hmm. Now they've got another guy, okay, who makes some shots coming off the bench, who Forbes was a knockdown shooter all of a sudden, taking Patty's spot on certain nights.
Yeah, Bertans makes shots from the three-point line, doesn't come inside that too much. And the thing I like about him, we talked about this, Mike, earlier a little bit, is, you know, he tells his good shooters to go ahead and shoot a lot of threes. He tells the other guys, hey, look, we're going to ease up a little bit on just firing threes up there. Drive and kick, get in the paint and pass it out. You can take threes late in the clock, but don't take them early. Let's not settle. Let's just keep attacking. And I think every time the ball gets in the paint, it puts so much pressure on the defense, Mike, that, you know, you get fouls driving the paint, but those kick-out shots, when you get in the paint and you throw it out, everybody shoots those better. There's more rhythm on that shot.
What I love about Pop is he goes against the grain a lot of times, from the standpoint that he doesn't just do what the hot thing to do in the league is. You remember the year back before he won the series against Miami, they shot a lot of threes and won games by shooting threes. Yeah. Then they got to the Miami series that year, moved the ball better than we've ever seen in a long, long time, and that became the new thing. Let's pass the ball quickly. And then he goes back to this kind of team, which is pieces and parts, and he puts it together and plays to what the player's strengths are, what they can do, and this is how we're going to play. We're not going to play the way the league wants us to play.
That's one of the things that he told us as we had the Spurs on TNT on Thursday night. Our broadcast team had a meeting with him prior to the game and asked how it is that he's been able to maintain the Spurs system when the league has gone in such a different playing style direction. And he told us exactly that he's not going to go in that direction simply because the league has, but because he's going to find the strengths of the personnel that he has. He doesn't have the Golden State Warriors roster, so he's not going to make the San Antonio Spurs play the way that they play.
Well, when you have the ability to take your ego and sit down with your best player and say to him, What am I doing wrong? What can I do different?
Yeah.
And it turns the entire thing around with LaMarcus Aldridge, where you had a guy who wanted out, wanted to leave, and now winds up getting back to playing like it was the Aldridge from Portland because the coach is willing to sit down and say, what am I doing wrong and how can I make or use you better?
Yeah, and he didn't say, I'm going to take DeMar DeRozan and turn him into a three-point shooter coming up. He puts me, he lets him iso, but he isos off of action. He'll have a pin-down action to a curl, open up the side, and let DeRozan go to work. So he allows his guys to be who they are inside of his system because, you know, he just doesn't come down, throw you the ball, and all four guys stand on the other side. They have movement inside of their offense. So when DeRozan is isoing, it's really often he's coming from the weak side corner with a double pin down action to the top, opening it up for his left or right hand drive. And so they use actions to get him into his iso. And I think he's done great. And, you know, that's one of those weird deals. It doesn't happen in our league a lot. It's happened a few times lately where both teams really benefit from the trade. Like, I just think Kawhi had to get out of San Antonio. That just wasn't going to work. He goes to Toronto. They're, you know, leading the Eastern Conference and playing great basketball. And DeRozan is helping the Spurs kind of turn their whole season around and become a whole different team that plays a little differently than Pop teams normally do, but still very effective.
Well, we're going to be back with more on an 8-game Monday night in the NBA, including Blake Griffin. You just mentioned Bertans. Well, unfortunately here, this is a low light, not a highlight. As he gets the reverse dunk.
We didn't say anything about his defense, though. We said he shoots the ball.
Yeah, exactly. That's a fair point by you. Well, the NBA on TNT is Thursday night with a doubleheader, starting with the Celtics in Miami to take on the Heat at 7 Eastern, followed by the Thunder in San Antonio to take on the Spurs at 9:30. Your coverage starts with Game Time at 6 right here on NBA TV. Look at this. Look how happy DeMar is to see Coach Casey prior to this game.
Yeah. Good to see that.
Casey's
Dwayne's a really good man. I like him.